This week on Jerusalem Dateline, long-term enemies Israel and Saudi Arabia shake hands and unite against their common enemy, Iran. Plus, the Supreme Court weighs in on whether you can be born in Jerusalem, Israel. Also, is ISIS planning a dirty bomb? And hearing the hearts of Christians who fled the brutal rampage of ISIS. All this and more this week on Jerusalem Dateline. Hello and welcome to this edition of Jerusalem Dateline. I'm Chris Mitchell. We're coming to you this week with the walls of the old city and the Jaffa Gate behind me. Against the backdrop of a pending deal over Iran's nuclear program, an unprecedented meeting took place in Washington, D.C. last week. A meeting between Israel and Saudi Arabia sent one more signal of a historic geopolitical change taking place in the Middle East. At the Council on Foreign Relations, Israel's incoming Director General of the Foreign Ministry, Dori Gold, met with Anwar Majed Eski, his Saudi Arabian counterpart. These historic enemies sent the same message. Iran is trying to take over the Middle East, and it must be stopped. At the event, Israel and Saudi Arabia revealed they have met five times in the last year and a half in secret. That revelation and the rare public meeting seemed designed to send a clear message to President Obama's White House.
The Saudi message is basically President Obama, listen to Prime Minister Netanyahu. The Saudis identify fully with the Israeli perception of the Iranian threat. They totally disagree with a very naive misperception of Iran by President Obama.
Iranian press TV even covered the event, and the timing of the meeting seemed planned. It fell in the shadow of the June 30th deadline for the nuclear talks in Lausanne, Switzerland, between Iran, the U.S., and five other world powers.
In fact, the Saudis and the Israelis are very, very concerned about President Obama being preoccupied with Lausanne, which conflicts dramatically with the reality in the Persian Gulf. In fact, the Iranians are trying to topple every single pro-American Arab regime.
Former Israeli Ambassador Yoram Ettinger says the threat Iran poses explains the change in relations.
And as far as the Saudis are concerned, Israel constitutes the most effective life insurance, which they have right now, in face of Iran.
While Saudi Arabia, a major Sunni power, and Israel have been enemies for decades, they both see Shiite Iran's nuclear program as a threat to their very existence. Huge differences remain between these two historic foes, but for now their alliance seems a classic example of the Middle East maxim, the enemy of my enemy is my friend. Just days after Gold's revelation, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu told the Herzliya conference that he knows he's often portrayed as the, quote, nuclear party pooper, but he's not alone in the region.
And it's worth noting that no one from this region, except Iran, is at the negotiating table. Somebody once said, if you're not at the table, you're on the menu.
Americans born in Jerusalem will not have Israel as their country of birth on their passports. The Supreme Court struck down a congressional law that allowed them to do so, even though in practice it was never implemented. The court ruled 6-3 that Congress overstepped its bounds when it approved the passport law in 2002. The key question in the case involves the status of Jerusalem. The U.S. doesn't recognize it as Israel's capital and says the city's status should be resolved between Israel and the Palestinians. Another political hot potato is the U.S. State Department policy of stamping the passports of Americans born in biblical Judea and Samaria with the pro-Palestinian term West Bank. The Lassard family lives in Givat Ze'ev, a thriving community of 12,000 residents just 2 miles from Jerusalem. Washington calls it part of the occupied territories in the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. But some say that the State Department is going too far when it records the birthplace for Americans like the Lassard's children.
We have home births. So he was born here, really in the West Bank, as the Americans like to call it. We call it Judea and Samaria. This is Jewish land here. It's been Jewish land since the time of Abraham.
In Jerusalem, an estimated 1,000 Americans are born each year, and their documents say only Jerusalem. No country is recorded for their birth. It's the only place in the world where that's the case. Yisrael Medad says it's the principle that matters.
It is very, shall we say, injurious to Israel's position in the political diplomatic world and doesn't make any sense.
According to Medad, no one has ever declared the West Bank a state. And even the Palestinians don't call it that. But the State Department insists on using it as an official location.
They're engaged in political diplomatic creationism. They're creating a state that doesn't exist. They take away Israel from Jerusalem, but they add West Bank to Ramallah, Nablus, or Bethlehem, or Shiloh, or Elon Shvut.
In response, the State Department told CBN News that the final political status of Jerusalem has been in dispute since 1948 as a result of the long-standing Arab-Israeli conflict. The U.S. government has pursued a policy of encouraging the parties to that conflict to settle all outstanding issues, including the final status of Jerusalem, through peaceful negotiations between the parties, with the support of the broader international community. Therefore, the U.S. government does not acknowledge the sovereignty of any state over Jerusalem. Regarding the West Bank, the State Department said the applicant can decide whether a settlement name or West Bank is listed as the place of birth. The Lasards say they probably won't pursue changes to their children's documents, but Medad says he wants to see the White House take action.
The White House should take the lead and tell the State Department, cut out all this bureaucracy. This is the situation. If it changes in some sort of future peace agreement, that's one thing. At the present moment, we all know Jerusalem is the capital. Judea and Samaria are being administered by Israel.
Another alarming development in the fight against ISIS. There are reports the terror group may now have the ability to build a so-called dirty bomb. The news comes as the U.S. announces it will send more military advisors to Iraq. Heather Sells has the latest.
The new report about ISIS's plans comes from Australian intelligence. The Australian foreign minister says the Islamic terrorists took the materials that could be used to build a dirty bomb from government facilities in Syria and Iraq. ISIS itself has declared plans to develop weapons of mass destruction in its online magazine. And the Daily Mail is reporting that ISIS says it could buy a nuclear device from corrupt officials in Pakistan. ISIS could then possibly smuggle a nuclear weapon into the United States. For now, some experts fear ISIS will ramp up its terror campaign with the start of Ramadan next week. They're also concerned about plans for violence to mark its one-year anniversary as a caliphate on June 29th. As the U.S. moves to contain ISIS, the president has announced he'll send several hundred extra military advisors to Iraq. The goal, help Iraqi fighters take back the strategic city of Ramadi. Despite ongoing criticism that the president's strategy isn't working, the White House says it's making the right moves.
The president and his team are confident that for now, 450 troops are additional military personnel are what is necessary to fulfill this expanded advise and assist and training mission.
It's comments like that, say critics, that indicate a policy failure. More striking, perhaps, are the obvious challenges that ISIS now controls large portions of Iraq and that it could build a dirty bomb, inflicting both serious physical and psychological damage. Heather Sells, CBN News.
Up next, hear the hearts of Christians who fled for their lives when ISIS invaded their town. Welcome back. A report out of the Middle East claims an ISIS fighter converted to Christianity after an encounter with Jesus Christ. CBN News' Lori Johnson and senior international correspondent Gary Lane discussed that report.
This account was told to Todd Nettleton on VOM Radio. He has a regular half-hour weekly show on VOM Radio that's on the internet. And he was told this by a missionary from YWAM by the name of Gina Fadley. And let's take a listen to what she had to say.
The fighter admitted that he had killed Christians and that he had actually enjoyed doing so. He told this YWAM leader that he had begun having dreams of this man in white who came to him and said, "You are killing my people." The fighter said that just before he killed one Christian, the man said, "I know you will kill me, but I give to you my Bible." The Christian was killed, and this ISIS fighter actually took the Bible and began to read it.
Wow.
And then in another dream, Jesus asked him to follow him. And he was now asking to become a follower of Christ and to be discipled.
Wow, that's absolutely riveting.
It is,
and this is a very exciting story, of course.
Yes.
But what should we Christians look for, out for, you know, regarding stories like
well,
this?
Well, you know, Lori, I did talk to Todd Nettleton about this, and I said, "Todd, how credible is this?" He said, "Well, we fully trust the YWAM people because we work with YWAM around the world. VOM has a good partnership with them. They trust them. Their missionaries are on the ground. But you have to be careful. Is this firsthand? Their YWAM missionary actually met the man, met this ISIS fighter."
Yeah, approach these types of things with a bit of skepticism.
Yeah.
I mean,
but
we would all
exciting.
Like for it to be true.
Yes.
And yes, we have heard other reports of Muslims, not only ISIS members, but other Muslims coming to Christ. And so many of them do it through dreams and visions.
What's exciting is when there are no missionaries on the ground, God finds a way. The Holy Spirit moves. People come to Christ because they really long that in their long for that in their hearts, and God makes a way, doesn't He?
He absolutely does. Gary, thanks so much for sharing your information with us.
It's been just over a year that ISIS captured Mosul, ancient Nineveh. They went on to seize most of what's called the Nineveh Plain. It's estimated well over 100,000 Christians fled ISIS. As the terror army continues its advance through Syria and Iraq, they've left thousands of refugees and shattered lives in their wake. Here's a look from Jordan at how some Christians who fled the Islamic State are trying to rebuild their lives. For Amar and his family, the bell tolled at midnight.
Very strange bells ring in this time. And loudspeakers call us, all of you go out from Karakosh. ISIS is coming and there is no one to protect you. So I take my family, my wife, my children, and go.
Like the rest of those in the Christian village of about 60,000, Aman's family fled for their lives. Many headed to Erbil, the capital of Kurdistan. Others escaped to Dahuk, a major Kurdish city near the Turkish border. Months later, some have made it to Amman, Jordan's capital, and its surrounding towns.
Until now, we can't even imagine this happening to us. It's like a dream. Everything was so normal. Our life was so comfortable, and suddenly everything changed.
Changed by terrorists with a deadly goal.
They don't want any Christians to live in Iraq. They want to kill them all or have them leave or become a Muslim.
But they escaped and gave the credit to God.
Jesus made for us. The miracle is save my family. I have a wife and three daughters. Yeah. Jesus saved them from ISIS.
While they're still without a country, these families fared better than most. They live in a nice apartment, thanks to help from an Anglican priest known as the Vicar of Baghdad. His name is Canon Andrew White. His organization provides homes and other help for refugees.
We need provision. But we also need protection because each of us has come from such a violent place. I doubt whether there's a child in this class who has not had their loved ones killed.
Many Iraqi Christians have fled and found refuge here in Jordan. And most of the school children here have come from Mosul, ancient Nineveh, or the surrounding Christian villages and towns in northern Iraq. And nearly everyone here has fled because of ISIS. The school brought hope.
They had nothing, and now they have structure to their life and hope for the future.
Through all the trauma and heartache, their faith remains firm.
in the United States and the West, people need to know that these people have nothing, but they have everything. Because they know that Yeshua, Jesus, is real and central to their lives.
The children continue to sing the Lord's Prayer in Aramaic. Families continue to read their Bibles, and given the choice to deny the Lord, they refused.
He died for us on the cross. I can't deny Jesus. I can't deny him.
For now, they look to the UN and other nations for help, and to the church for prayer.
Pray for us. We are in a very hard situation here. Me, I am good, but there are so many people living in camps in Erbil, in Iraq. Here in Jordan, the life is very difficult. Especially here in Jordan, there is no work. We're not allowed to work, the Iraqi people. So we want them to pray for us.
Coming up, Dr. Michael Yusuf from Leading the Way Ministries talks about how the church in the West needs to take up the cause of persecuted Christians in the Middle East. Welcome back. American pastor Saeed Abedini has once again been beaten by fellow prisoners in Iran. His wife Nagmi writes about the attack on her Facebook page, saying, "It is truly heartbreaking to know that one day after I spoke in front of our Congress, Saeed was beaten by fellow prisoners. The attack happened Wednesday of last week as he was attempting to leave his cell. Pastor Saeed was punched in the face near his left eye and nose. His attackers also destroyed a small table he used to study and read. Prison guards did intervene when he called for help." In another statement, Nagmi writes, "It's time to get Saeed home before it's too late." Saeed has been beaten multiple times in the past, including by prison guards. Earlier this week, we talked about the plight of persecuted Christians in the Middle East with Dr. Michael Yusuf from Leading the Way Ministries. He talked about how he wants to see the church in the West wake up to how their brothers and sisters in the Middle East are suffering. You're doing something called Help the Persecuted. What is that?
It was my son Joshua, who leads the media ministry, who came up and said, "You know, you're preaching the gospel, people are being converted, and when they get converted, they get thrown out of their homes or out of their jobs. And so as a result of your preaching, these people are suffering." This is about 3 or 4 years ago. And, you know, our budget is skewed toward media, toward broadcasting. So our board made a decision that we will take part of that budget to help give people opportunity to support a third leg of our ministry, which we call Help the Persecuted. And because the need is huge, I mean, you know, trillions of dollars, well, I don't know, billions of dollars. And so we couldn't do everything, so we decided to focus our attention on those who are suffering for the sake of Christ as a result of their conversion to Christ. Mm-hmm. They're the ones who get thrown out. So we're trying to help our brothers and sisters with whom we're going to be spending eternity in heaven.
That's right, yeah. We had the opportunity last summer to be in northern Iraq and interview some of these Christians that were thrown out of their homes that had lived in for years or generations. And so that gave us a heart for the persecuted. What do you think the church in the U.S., particularly in the West, need to know about their persecuted brothers and sisters?
I think that they need to be informed. And then even some of those who are informed, and I get it on my social media, Twitter and Facebook, and people say, "Well, Michael, just give up. This is the end of end time, and this is going to happen anyway." But how in the world can you close your heart of compassion toward the people with whom you're going to spend eternity when they are suffering so severely in a way that we could never imagine? Somebody in America or in the West can't even imagine what that means when you see a child put on a cross. It is too horrific. Even the Muslim president of Egypt, when the 21 Christian Egyptians were beheaded in the Mediterranean, he said, "I didn't have the heart to go to the cathedral and to express my condolences until I've revenged the blood of those Christians." And yet, in the West, we do very little because we're A, not informed, B, if we are informed, We said, oh, isn't that too bad? There's something that has to happen, and I'm praying that the Spirit of God will awaken the church in America, just wake them up from the lethargy and from the self-satisfaction and from, you know, bless me club and, you know, the prosperity, it's for me and me and me and my family, that we will open our eyes and look at the need of the world. And I never preach something that I don't practice personally as well as our church. From the very beginning, we said 28 years ago when we started the church, we said every 20 cents of every dollar that comes into the church is going to go out to mission work. And we have done a lot more, of course, since then. But I think that's what the church in America needs to do. They need to be awakened to the incredible needs. And if they believe it's the end times, what are you keeping it for? For the Antichrist to use it? Mm-hmm. Start giving it to the work of the kingdom, all the work of God. It's ministries like CBN and TBN, all the ministries that have been doing some great work. And I'm not saying we're the only ones, but there are great ministries. Franklin Graham is doing a great job. And so I am pleading with believers to do their homework, to find out where the need is, and get plugged in.
Coming up, an ancient church reveals more about how pilgrims hundreds of years ago made their way to Jerusalem. Welcome back. Just outside of Jerusalem, the Israeli Antiquities Authority uncovered the remains of a 1,500-year-old Byzantine church. The church was discovered as contractors widened the road from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem. An archaeologist said the church was part of a larger complex that also served as a road station for pilgrims on their way to Jerusalem.
The location of the church is not accidental. On one hand, it's built beneath a water spring, which in Arabic is called Ein Naka, and on the other side, it's built on the one of the ancient roads leading from Jerusalem, between Jerusalem and the coast. This was a road station, which besides giving services of food and drink, it also gave religious services.
Other churches discovered along this route include a church in Emmaus, the traditional site where, according to the New Testament, Jesus appeared to two of his disciples. Many of those pilgrims 15 centuries ago were on their way here to the city of Jerusalem. 1,500 years later, Christian pilgrims are still being drawn to this city. Well, that's it for this edition. I'm Chris Mitchell. We'll see you next time on Jerusalem Dateline.